Good afternoon. Here, let me get a mic for you, Alan.
I thank all you for being here and helping us all celebrate.
I'd like to thank all you people for being here and giving us a chance to celebrate for an old man. Because, you know, there's a whole lot of other old men in Okay. Well, we'll hope we get a chance again. Thank you.
Well, my job's done then. Not as good as you, sir. My name is Pastor Ryan, and on behalf of Alan and their family, I want to welcome you and thank you for being here today to celebrate Gene Morris's life. I've actually never seen everybody just kind of hang around and chat and avoid getting, you know, those coveted seats before until it was right before. So y'all are a good group. We have the privilege today of giving thanks. And mourning. And those things in the Christian faith are held together. The sting of death is real, and we feel that today. There's loss and there's grief. But we also mourn with those that have hope. And the scriptures invite us to give thanks in all circumstances. I'm glad it doesn't say to give thanks for all circumstances. But in everything that we experience, to give thanks. And so today we celebrate the life of Gene Morris, and through song and scripture and sharing, we remember her and we celebrate this wonderful person. You'll have an opportunity later to share, so if you want to think about something brief, that a memory or a favorite verse or a thought about Gene's life, you'll have an opportunity to do that later. But would you join me in prayer as we begin? Jesus, we thank you that you are present with us. Thank you that you bring peace that goes beyond all understanding, and that you have overcome the grave. And so today, as we celebrate Gene's life, we mourn and we grieve, we feel the loss, and we rejoice and we celebrate. Not just in her life, but in what you've accomplished and the hope that we all have. And so today, through memories and sharing, God, we pray that you would be honored and that Gene would be honored, and that the joy that goes beyond our sorrow would be felt by each and every one of us today. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen.
In humble earth. and as it grew from a small firm to one of the biggest insurance companies in Eugene. She began in an era of hand crank adding machines and retired in a time of computers and email. She was elected president of Insurance Women of Eugene and was Insurance Woman of the Year. Her husband Alan was a teacher and a coach, and sports became a big part of her life, first watching Dave, Dan, and Doug play, and then watching Alan coach football, track, and basketball, highlighted by Alan's 1983 Harrisburg girls basketball team that finished second in state. After Dan and Doug finished high school, Jean and Alan built a house in the woods in Harrisburg, the Harrisburg area, and lived there until they retired. After they retired, Jean and Alan moved to Canby to be near her sister Marge and her mother Eva. They made new friends there and hosted many family Thanksgivings and Christmas celebrations. They made trips to Europe, Alaska, and several University of Oregon bowl games. She loved the Ducks. We'll forgive her anyway. And the Blazers, yay. And Clyde Drexler, W-A. Alan continued to coach. Now, is this right, Dave? Continued to coach in pole vault until his 70s?
Me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You were pole vaulting or coaching?
Both.
When we're done, Alan, I'm going to shake your hand. As Jean worked on craft projects and taking care of a long string of stray cats, must be some stories there. In her early 60s, Jean developed a brain tumor and lost the sight of one eye. She overcame this as well and lived the last 20 years of her life with only partial sight in that one eye. In 2015, Jean and Alan came to the Canby House and downsized to an apartment in Cascade Park in Woodburn. This was the place that she personally selected. She loved it there, and the people were well and loved her as well. She survived a heart attack and a broken ankle in her first few months there, but she recovered and had a good 2.5 years there with Alan. In October, she had a fall and sustained a traumatic brain injury that required surgery. Once again, Jean fought valiantly, but ultimately complications from that injury were too much. Jean is survived by her husband of 62 years, Alan, her younger sister, Lynn, her husband, Rich, her three sons, Dave and his wife, Sue, Dan and Doug, six grandchildren, Vanessa Gardner, Stephen Morris, Eric Morris, Rachel Morris, Patrick Morris, and Thomas Morris, and two great-grandchildren, Peyton and Lillian Gardner. She was preceded in death by her father, Frank Montgomery, her mother, Eva Montgomery McMichael, her stepfather, Riley McMichael, and her sister, Marge Brokey. She has dearly loved her family as they loved her, and of course, she will be dearly missed. She will always be with us, Dave writes in that obituary.
From your lips she drew the hallelujah. I know this room, and I've walked this floor. I used to live alone before I knew him. I've seen your flag on the marble arch. Love is not a victory march. It's a cold and it's a broken hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Great things that my mother actually gave all us sons, and my dad as well.
is the gift of music. Probably being the least musically talented of the brothers, it meant a lot to me that my mother always told me she liked hearing me play. And I was playing a bunch of old music from the 1850s, old Stephen Foster tunes and old minstrel songs. I was playing Genie with the Light Brown Hair, and Mom says, you know, that's, she really liked that song. I said, well, you know, why, Mom? It's a cheesy tune. And she goes, well, Dan, I'm Genie, and I got light brown hair. So of course I guess. Another thing that my mother actually, you know, I inherited from her was her sense of humor. And she, I learned a lot of great jokes from Mom, but unfortunately most of them were not fit to be told in church. So without further ado, because Mom did like people actually come to a point, I'm going to play Genie with the Light Brown Hair. And as Stephen Foster said, I'll try to get this out without getting maudlin. I long for Genie, and my heart bows low, never more to find her, for the bright waters flow.
Before we get started, I've got to do something here. people, my dad said, thank you guys all for being here. I mean, the only really sad thing for me here is that Mom's not here. She would really love seeing each and every one of you. We get together like this, at times like this, to remember. And for some reason, it's better to remember together with people that know the same people that you did. And there's going to be a time a little bit later that Pastor Ryan already talked about that you'll have time to share a story, and Pastor Ryan and Pastor Ron will walk around with the mic and give you a chance to share anything you might want to share about Mom. I would encourage you to do that and think about it a little bit. And I know that I would love to hear your stories. We've heard a few, mostly from me and my brothers, but it helps to remember together. It's funny, but when I started thinking about things that I remembered about Mom, the first things that came to my mind were times when she wasn't very happy with me. And I can remember one time when I was a little kid, and I was probably, I don't know, 8, 9, or 10, something like that, I did something that she didn't like, and I was going to get a spanking. And so she got the wooden spoon, and I headed out the front door. And I had this image, we're running around the house, and here's this little lady that laid like 100 pounds soaking wet, chasing this little boy around the house with a wooden spoon in her hand. And it must have been comical to her, because she started laughing. I thought I was off the hook, so I came back to her, and I got a spanking. So the moral of the story here, I think, is if you don't do the right thing, there's consequences. But Mom still loves you anyway. Another time I was in junior high, and I brought home a report card that I was perfectly fine with, and she noticed that this really wasn't the same kind of report card she'd been used to seeing for me. And she asked me about it, and I said, well, it's not too bad. She said, well, that's not your best. You can do better than that, and I know you can do better. And it's not okay to not do your best. It's not okay not to use your best, do your best. When I was a senior in high school, I broke my arm wrestling. And so that ended wrestling season, and I still had a cast on my arm halfway through track season. But at that time in my life, I did a lot of running, and I was, you know, getting in better shape. And halfway through the summer, I was probably in the best shape of my life. And I went into the doctor, and they said, well, these bones haven't healed, so we're going to have to do a bone graft. And that comes off the shin bone on your leg, and you have to put a cast on your leg. And I was just really upset about this because, you know, a lot of my friends were people I ran with, and this wasn't just something that I did as a sport, it was something that was a social thing for me. And I was whining and kind of feeling sorry for myself. And my mom sympathized for a while, and then she set me down and said, you know, you got to get over this. You know, you can't just be moping around the house and making everybody else try to make everybody else feel sad. No whining. So that's lesson number 3 from Mom. Do your best, no whining, and if you don't do the right thing, there will be consequences. And again, these were good rules. If you live by these, you could get along with Mom. And I think pretty good rules to live by in life. So what can I tell you about Mom? So the Bible talks about a certain kind of person in the last book of the Bible as a person who overcomes. And I think Doug already touched on this, and Pastor Ron touched on it in the obituary. My mom overcame a lot of things. I think that word describes Mom. She was an overcomer. You know, we heard about her early life growing up in Depression, Kansas, and having her mom go away, her parents went away to work in the shipyards during the war. Her dad died when she was 15. So when a little boy comes to her and he's whining because he got a cast on his leg, she'd been through more things by the time she was a senior in high school than I ever dreamed of in my fairly easy life. When she was around 60, she had a brain tumor that caused her the sight in one eye. But she didn't whine a lot about this either. You know, she wasn't able to drive anymore, but she really didn't, other than that, you really didn't notice that much. You could sneak up on her about from one side and sometimes sad. But she continued to run her house, and she did handicrafts, really detailed things, and arts and crafts things, even with a limited vision. Later in her life, she contracted diabetes. But she attacked that the same way she attacked everything else. Figure out what to do about it and do your best. She figured out how to eat. She figured out how to take care of her blood sugar, and she moved on. She was the poster girl for managing your diabetes. At 83, she had a heart attack, an open heart surgery, and that was another pretty rough blow. And then after she got out of the hospital, she ran her scooter into a wall and broke her ankle, which sent her back to rehab for another month and a half. So she had 4 months either in the hospital or in rehab. And she got through that too. And she battled back from that, and once again, she overcame. And she overcame everything in her life, and we really thought she was going to overcome this last one too, but you don't overcome them all. Eventually you fought the good fight, and you finished the race. So my brothers and I actually grew up with two wonderful parents. We grew up thinking that was normal. We thought everybody had parents like ours. And we find out later that it wasn't so normal. And we were very blessed and very lucky. But Mom and Dad were very different, because Mom was really the one who took care of us. When we were growing up, Mom had a full-time job, but she was still the one who cooked our meals, cleaned the house, paid the bills, and made sure we had the money to go to college. Dad decided where we would go fishing, what game we were going to watch on TV, and what kind of boat we were going to have. So that's important to him, you know. But they both had very different jobs. And Mom, when I was in between my first 2 years of college, I was having trouble finding a job, so Mom found me. She used her connections at work to land me a job with an irrigation company digging ditches. And sometimes taking care of somebody means letting them know that they have to help out to do the things that they really need to do. Throughout my life, my mom was always somebody that people would call on to talk to. And I didn't really understand this as I was a kid, you know, why she would talk to people, just listen to people for an hour on the phone that were going through all kinds of different problems. But I must like that kind of person, because I ended up marrying one. And a pastor friend of mine who's here today often says, being listened to feels like being loved. And I think that's right. I think it really does. For all those people that Mom talked to, and there may be some of them here, that feels like being loved. At every stage in her life, she picked up a new group of friends. There I see that some of them from the Trump and McKinley days are here, and that was a big part of her life for almost 40 years. She had great friends in her life from when they lived in the Harrisburg area, and some of them are here today. You know, this is going to make my wife happy. She's been unhappy with me because I haven't cried enough. So, Doug, you can thank you that you got that started. There was a special connection with Dad and Mom and the girls who were on his basketball teams, especially the one that finished second in state in 1983. And Dad still called him, always called him his girls. Some of his girls now have grandchildren. But they're always his girls, you know, I think that's kind of the way it is. She picked up new friends when she moved to Canby, some of them are here today. And even after she retired and moved into Cascade Park, she continued to make new friends. And some of those people were very, very sad when she died. About 4 years ago, Mom realized that her and Dad couldn't continue to live on their own forever, so she started making plans to move. And once again, Mom was taking care of us even years ahead of time. Her house needed some foundation work, so she called and got two contractors, and then she called me, you know, being the engineer, and asked me what I thought. And so I looked over the bids, and gave her my opinion, and she chose the other one. and for some reason, that really didn't surprise me at all. My mom did the research and found a place for Mom and Dad to live at Cascade Park in Woodburn, and she loved it. She organized an estate sale, sold the house, set up the movers, rented storage units, picked the date to move. She was 82 years old when she did all this. We always thought of my mom as indestructible. We thought of her as the rock star. She loved Cascade Park, and the people who knew her for a long time, they loved her too. For the first time in her life, though, people were taking care of her, which was a little bit different. But she wasn't then taking care of us. When Mom died, there was already a company set up to take care of her body. There was a place picked out for her ashes, and I've been getting 2 to 3 phone calls a week from a company that handles all these different details that you don't think about until somebody actually dies. Mom's still taking care of us. We didn't realize it at the time, but she had also picked out a place that Dad was going to be able to live after she was gone. You know, you never know who's going to be the one that's going to be there by themselves. So in a way, she's continuing to take care of us, continuing to take care of Dad. Mom and Dad were married for 62 years, That's a long time. But I can tell you one thing from mom's life. If you want to have a lot of anniversary celebrations, don't get married on December 22nd. Not the only real anniversary celebrations we have for them were the big ones, the 40, the 50, the 60, and the 25. But it's a little too close to Christmas. Sometimes I talk with mom about God. We didn't really talk a lot about God in my family. I think most of my family members believe your faith is a personal thing and that you don't talk a lot about. But there was a phrase my grandma Irma used to use when she was talking about somebody who was a Christian. She would say, well, he knew where he was going. And I think there's some truth to that. Mom knew where she was going. She believed that Jesus Christ was her Savior. She prayed for her kids and her grandkids and her friends. She's reminded me that she was baptized, as Pastor Ron said, the First Baptist Church, Medicine Lodge, Kansas. But in her adult life, she really was never a regular church attender. So how do you know where you were going? I guess you've got to go back to the words that Jesus said, as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, all men will know you are my disciples, if you love one another. This room testifies that my mom loved people. This is how we know. This is how we know. There was another time Jesus was talking to Peter. This is, he had already died, he had been resurrected, he was about to return to heaven. And Jesus asked Peter three times if he loved him. Three times Peter replied back, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus told Peter, feed my lambs, take care of my sheep, feed my lambs. Mom spent most of her life taking care of people. I'm happy to be counted among her lambs, even though I probably look more like a grumpy old ram at this point in my life. To your mom, you're always a lamb, right? If there was a final message from mom's life, I think this would be it. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. And take care of my lambs. Take care of each other. Love one another. Have those friendships that, where somebody can call you on the phone and talk to you. I don't think she would have quoted the Bible verses, maybe, but she would have agreed with the thoughts. Thank you, Mom. You fought the good fight. You finished the race. Now there's a story of you, the crown of righteousness from the Lord. You were a fighter. You overcame many tough things. But through it all, you were really fighting for us. Now it's up to us to carry on your work. Life is tough. Take care of yourself. Take care of each other. Be a good friend, be a godly parent, be a faithful spouse, do the right thing, always do your best, and no whining. We gather to remember together, but I think as we move ahead, you know, we want to not forget. We don't want to forget the people that touch our lives, the people that love us and leave us with a message that we carry on, though, that they're not really gone, they're always good.
Someone
like to just create some space for anybody that would like to share brief stories. If you would do us the honor of saying your name and maybe how you know or have known Gene and the family, and then just share a brief memory. You can. I'll bring the mic to you. Pastor Ron nominated me. That's how this works. So I will. I'll run the mic to you. And who would like to start off? That's always the hardest one. All right. Okay. I can tell this is going to be fun.
My name is Pam Swango, and when I was a senior in high school, I went into my science class, and we had a new teacher, and his name was Alan Morris. And I then walked out during the later part of the year and met Jean and the little boys when she brought him the stroller, one she had hanging on to her arm because she didn't want him to get away out where she didn't know anybody. But what I really want to tell you about is every time Al and Jean moved, I love animals. And she loved her cats. And so she would call me up and she'd say, Pam, you and Jeannie are coming down to help us move and you're in charge of the cats. And I'd say, okay, I'll be there.
Mr. Morris, we're the basketball girls, and we're the basketball team. Oh, Tammy, is there another basketball player?
Tammy.
Oh yeah, come on up, Tammy. Sorry.
I don't know what to
call you. Oh yeah, you can have. So Mr. Morris was our basketball coach, and we went to state in 1983. I'll just say a few things. We remember him kicking a lot of chairs. I know, Tricia, you took a lot of ride home.
Oh, yes. Me and Mr. Morris, we and Gene, we were neighbors, just a few doors down.
Maybe if I rode over there, would you tell me about her wife?
Yeah, I was pretty tight-lipped back then. Mr. Morris, I was also a black guy, so it's a lot of rides home that, you know, that didn't matter because we had a connection, and it didn't matter, you know, if they were speaking a lot or nothing. It was just natural.
It was there.
Yeah, it was just that.
You know what I think it all boils down to? In our own way, we love each other.
That's right. And Jean, what I want to say about Jean is that she was such an unwavering supporter of our teams, not just the basketball team, but all of your teams. And she put a lot of time into the scrapbooks that were this thick for every team that at the basketball teams at least. I don't know about the others, but she had scrapbooks this thick. And she passed them on, I believe, to Martha. And such a wonderful gift. And I really enjoyed having lunch with you and Jean at your new place about spring of 2017, I believe. And I wasn't in high school anymore. I was prepared to pay for my lunch. She insisted to pay for my lunch. It was just a delight to talk to you both. And she's just a joy. I'm going to miss her.
Thank you.
So, Al was not only my coach, but my teacher. And he gave up his senior prep period, my senior year, his prep period, because Harrisburg didn't have a physics program, so he taught physics during his prep. I'm not really sure there was a lot of teaching. There was a lot of eating, because it was his lunch period. But we all appreciated that he did that, and I'll never forget that. And Jean would always stop me after a basketball game, and she knew my name. And she'd say, "Christy, you played good." And I'd say, "Thanks." And then she'd say, "How are your grades?" Not so good. So later in life, Al and I got to coach together, didn't we? It was fun.
Well, this is unexpected. I guess my biggest memory of Jean was sitting on those sidelines and cheering us all on as a team and working together as a team. And I have graduated before these girls, so these are the girls that took home the state championship. But again, we were all part of your family, and for that we thank you.
I just want to say one more thing about Mrs. Morris. After hearing the sons talk, I can see you had a wonderful wife, and she definitely organized everyone, and I can see how you all made it to the basketball games, and she would sit up there and cheer us on, and she probably went home and told you a few things that you needed to do. We love Jean. She was a great lady. Yeah.
When we were building our house, and this may be borderline for where we are as far as appropriateness, but, so forgive me in advance. We were building the house up on Wildwood Estates Loop, and we had jobs helping out. So I came, and we were living in downtown Harrisburg in a little rental house. And came back there at the end of the day, and Mom was there and says, "Well, what did you guys do today?" I says, "Well, we did a lot. We cut studs and framed walls, and this one section, we put the plywood on, and we laid joists. We did a whole bunch of other stuff." And she said, "Who's Joyce?"
About Jean is we built our houses about the same time, and so
Pam and I, Pam was in charge of the animals, but we also got handed paintbrushes and all kinds of things. So we were, Pam and I were over there one day helping Gene do some painting, but Al came in and he decided he needed to supervise. So he gets up on the scaffolding and he's supervising Gene, Pam, and I, and of course Pam and I are listening to Gene. And Gene turns around and she looks at Pam and I and she goes, "I guess he just thinks we're Al's angels." And I do have to say, I was privileged enough to take Jean to a Blazer game, and she was. She loved the Blazers, and she loved Clyde Drexler. And I'm honored enough to say that all of their duck things are in our duck room in the house. So they're in good care, guys.
I'm going to give this a whirl. I'm Arjoa Kane, and I worked with Gene for 35 years. Could not have had a better co-worker, friend. I have three boys. She had three boys, so you know, we knew a lot about what was going on. She was a good, good person. I love her dearly.
So I'm Thomas. I'm Gene's youngest grandson, and I remember coming back in the summer of last year, and I went to visit her, and I was just talking about how, you know, like, my mom was, like, pretty emotional about me joining the Army, and she was like, you know, I was just like, you know, it's mom being mom, but then she kind of just, like, explained to me, like, how, you know, she was, like, pretty not okay with my dad joining the military, and, like, how every time he went overseas, like, she just did not like it, and it just kind of made me understand where my mother was coming from. Like, you know, if Grandma Jean, who, like, was basically, like, the stable rock of everybody, could be, like, shaken by her son, you know, joining the military, then I could definitely understand why my mother would be frightened of me joining. So, yeah, it's just one of my favorite memories that I have of her.
Hi, I'm Rachel Morris, and I'm one of Jean's granddaughters, and my grandma Jean, she is the one who taught me to crochet, and I remember being in her room, like, being with her, being in her living room, and she handed me these really tiny crochet hooks and this really tiny thread, and it's like, well, this is a little small for a beginner, but here, give it a whirl. And I remember sitting there doing my best, and she's like, "Oh, well, these stitches are a little tight, so we'll just skip over them." And so she was my grandparent, and a lot of grandparents, they leave little heirlooms and stuff for their children, but I'm really lucky and happy that instead of leaving me heirlooms, she left me a skill. She taught me how to do something and how to make something with my own two hands. And it ended up igniting a fire in me for crafting and stuff, just like she had with all her, like, carved Santa Clauses and her jewelry and her crocheting. And I'm really gonna miss her, and I'm gonna miss being able to talk to her about stuff like that. So.
I'm Sherry Farino, and this is my husband, Bud, and our good neighbor, Goldie Hirely. And 20-some years ago, when Jean and Alan retired, we hit the jackpot because they moved right next door to us. Little did we know that Alan had my husband's high school clippings when he was an athlete. And I didn't know that Jean liked Clyde Drexler that much, because we would have fought. But I really did enjoy the fact that she enjoyed basketball, because that's my favorite sport to watch. She was just an amazing friend. She was like a big sister to me. And somehow, whenever I would be really sick, she would send Alan over with soup or something. But she advised me on so many things, and I was so proud of her crafting, and I'm so glad that the granddaughter mentioned that. And I don't know your faces, but I'll bet I know something about most of you. Because she dearly loved each one of you to a depth that is not expressible. But when they lived right next door to us, if we didn't know where our husbands were, we'd call each other. Because they were probably in Alan's den or on some adventure, because they were trouble buddies. And Jean and I were the stay-at-home kind, and so I learned all kinds of things from her, from recipes to medicine and all of those stories about you. She loved you very, very much, and she will be missed, more than I can say.
Yeah, I'm Bud Farino, and I just have to say, since we're doing this, it's hard to keep it short if you're going to tell a Morris story. My wife happened to mention, you know, it's such a small world. We live on a great street in Canada, you know,
Street.
It's not. It's a little closer here.
Okay. So, many years ago, then, these neighbors moved in, and we, Alan and I, got acquainted. So he goes in and gets a scrapbook because he's a Harrisburg guy, and it was the little school of Westburg. And I'm playing the sports, and he's coaching him he's coaching the Harrisburg boys when Westburg Harrisburg plays. So he goes and gets this book. So that's how we got acquainted. But then Jean, you know, we kind of hit it off good too, because she's such a sports lady. So I'd go over there, and if Alan was here or there, we would talk sports. Oregon, I mean, I'm a Beaver, she's a Duck, but we got along very well. But I wanted to just take a moment to tell about, there was a cat that was shown in there, the orange one, I think it was Harper.
Yes.
And one day, she came frantically looking for me because Harper disappeared. So I'm going all around the neighborhood looking for Harper, and something dawned on me that he might be in the back under deck. I go down crawling, and I see his little eyes underneath the deck, way back in where I can't reach. And I'm getting kind of ticked off at that point. I said, Parker, you get out here. Because Jean's just really, she's getting very nervous. And somehow he came out. And I picked him up. And, you know, talk about make her day. I'll never forget how I made Jean Morris's day for just a little while.
Like I said, Jean advised me on medical things, and in 2006 I had cancer, and I came home and I was in pretty bad shape, and I was reading Psalm 23, and I got to the line where, and he prepares the table before me in the presence of my enemies. Jean walked through my door with food. I have never had such a loving, special adopted sister, and she'll be always missed. But it was just amazing. She's written down in my Bible forever.
Okay, perhaps one or two more, and then there'll be time afterwards during the reception where you can share stories as well. Anybody else? Going once. Going twice. Okay, thank you. That was very wonderful to hear. We have one more special piece that the brothers, I hear this doesn't happen too often. So we'll see how it goes. But please enjoy this as they honor their mother.
Pardon me.
Gene's family, and the people of Corvallis Evangelical Church, we want to invite you now to a reception. There's cookie and coffee and all the things, all the comfort food that really just provide a chance for you to continue to share stories, to greet one another, to share memories. Thank you for coming. Would you do me a favor? Let's allow the family a chance to make their way back there first. Otherwise, they get clogged up here and they'll never get a cookie. So once they've been dismissed, you all can go ahead and follow in behind them. Thank you so much for coming and celebrating Gene's life with all of us.